Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Geography of the Imagination, 40 Essays, by Guy Davenport. Introduction by John Jeremiah Sullivan. Narrated by Paul Woodson. Introduction. The first time I met Guy Davenport, he slammed the door in my face. Physically, I mean. He opened it and he eyed me through the screen, then slammed the heavy wooden inner door closed in my face. Bam! He yelled from inside, "You do not look like John Jeremiah Sullivan." "Not fair," I replied. "I know your face. I've seen your author photos." He opened the door again, smiling, holding a cigarette in his fingers. I considered him a cherished friend from that moment until he died. This was at his great old house in Belcourt in Lexington, Kentucky. My grandmother lived just 2 blocks away. I could walk to visit him. His house was built in 1923, meaning it turns a century old this year. A squat, two-story brick house with a broad wooden staircase inside. I am writing this the way I am, in uniform lines of an arbitrary length, because he liked to do that, to draw boxes and write inside of them. It was a radical, literal form of constraint as the friend of the artist. Somehow it tied into his ideas on the oneness of form and meaning. This would have been 1999 or 2000. I was a books editor at Harper's. My friend Roger Hodge said, "Hey, don't you know Guy Davenport?" Guy and I had corresponded. I must have dropped his name. Oops. I wrote to him and asked if he would write a monthly books column. I was surprised when he agreed, though now, looking back, I can see how it was a gratifying invitation for him at that phase in his career. Not that he was forgotten, but it is nice knowing the kids revere you. The collaboration lasted barely 2 years, the friendship a few more, until Guy died of lung cancer at a Lexington hospital in January 2005. His partner and lover, Bonnie Jean Cox, survived him by 12 years. Bonnie was the director of the Collection Development Department at the University of Kentucky, where Guy was a professor of English. I loved Bonnie. She was nerdy and warm, but with Yankee sarcasm. She developed Alzheimer's right after Guy died and forgot everyone. Their vibe was, he would say outrageous things and she would chide. People joked that Bonnie Jean seems like a lesbian, and so does Guy. And it was kind of like that. They sort of seemed like a lesbian couple. Although, you know, not really. Guy had his own kind of masculinity. The strangest part of his biography was that he had been in the army. He understood well, like his hero, Fourier, that our sexuality's a chord made up of notes. We play a few in our lives and leave others muted. After Guy died, somebody tactlessly asked Bonnie Jean if he was gay. She said something quite colorful about how good the sex had been. I remember sitting with them in front of Guy's ground floor fireplace. He would burn trash in there, paper bags and empty cigarette packs. Now and then they would scrounge around for more stuff to throw in, especially after they'd exhausted the stack of rejected review copies, talking that famous Guy Davenport talk, which will never exist again. Literary historical free association, punctuated with dramatic pauses. Ready to laugh, but rarely silly, sometimes gossipy, sometimes bitchy. He might tell you about a conversation that he had with his neighbors, or about one that he had with Samuel Beckett at an old cafe in Paris. He told me an anecdote about a visit he'd had from Cormac McCarthy. From Guy, I learned that Cormac McCarthy goes by Charles or Charlie. He said that McCarthy had started petting Guy's cat, a vicious tomcat. Guy tried to warn him that the cat was mean and hated to be touched. Sure enough, the cat began to hiss and scratch and shredded his arm. Guy said it was wild to watch, because McCarthy didn't seem to care. He didn't even flinch, Guy said. Just smiled and kept petting the cat. Guy wasn't a name dropper. He just told these stories as they arose. He liked to hold ideas up to the light and rotate them in his fingertips. He moved between languages and millennia. I couldn't always follow. It might be more correct to say that I was almost never able to follow. He would occasionally make fun of me when I said something stupid. I asked if The Anatomy of Melancholy was written in English or Latin. John Jeremiah Sullivan, did you seriously just ask me that question? But I took notes, and the titles that I wrote down became my reading. Let me say, I don't want to pretend to have been a close friend of his. I knew him only during his last 5 years, and it was part professional. But it was a real friendship that marked me as a person and a writer, and I consider it part of my role in the world to honor his reputation. I don't think there was anyone like Guy. He was what's called a one-er. Obviously, it's a way of saying sui generis, but more than that, too, it means somebody who is remarkably keen. Guy might have guessed that one-er first shows up in Dickens in 1841. The range of knowledge he possessed was startling, even intimidating. Duke, Harvard, Oxford, Rhodes Scholar, MacArthur genius, ludicrous. At the same time, I think he was someone who sincerely believed that you can learn something interesting from every person you ever meet, and that no thought is really interesting until you can discuss it plainly. Curiosity was his philosophy, a way of being alive and liking the world. I remember the book he had been looking at on that day I first visited. It was a Chinese translation of one of his own short fiction collections. He told me a story. He said that a Chinese scholar friend had come by. Guy had shown him the book and asked him what the subtitle meant. The scholar gave him a generic answer like Foreign Literature Series. But what does it really mean? Guy asked. He wanted to understand the symbols. The man, who was Chinese, smiled with embarrassment. Finally, he told me, barbarian writings with fragrance of literature. Guy cackled. He loved that. I think it summarized how he saw himself, as somebody who was working at the end of a civilization or tradition. Modernism had been a cultural summit, like the Athenian Golden Age. We were living in the radioactive ashlands of whatever that involved. His line on the subject in Au Tombeau de Charles Fourier is immortal. We let the fire die in the engine. And yet, did his very existence not have something to say about that? Guy certainly kept something alive. Like Sir Ralph Percy at Hedgeley Moor, he saved the bird in his bosom. He clung to the beginnings, what he called the symbol of the archaic. Not Paul, but early Jesus. Not Socrates, but Heraclitus. Not God, but gods. He wrote stories that were like essays, and essays that were like stories. Many would argue that his reputation will wind up resting on the former, but the geography of the imagination is non-fiction and a masterpiece. As far as introducing it, I'd ask only that you enter it in a spirit of play. That is how it was written. Guy wrote in joy. He loved to make writings. He once defined despair as the sensation that you've run out of ideas. This book will never run out of ideas. It has so many running through it. Guy himself hands us the metaphor that leads to an optimal approach. The word labyrinth occurs in this book a full 44 times, and maze 13. His essay, The House That Jack Built, is all about labyrinths and mazes. It's one of the most mind-expanding literary essays that I've ever read. It offers a masterclass in his method, the archaeology of iconography. For me, it was the gateway drug that lured me into the rest of his work, aided by my brother Worth, who took English classes with him at UK. The essay is about books that both have mazes in them and are mazes. It gets Borgesian when you realize you're experiencing it in just such a book. But Guy doesn't try to be cute about it. He's working at a deeper level. A child's rhyme becomes a vocal imitation of the deepening labyrinth. A Midsummer Night's Dream is shown to take place in an actual maze. The Russian painter Chelitchev later took to concealing minotaurs, Guy writes, and made a Riddle of Daedalus, an anatomical drawing of the nasal labyrinth where we breathe. Guy hunted these things. He is the man who noticed that in all of Balthus one finds no clocks. I miss him very much. I miss the human being, not just the great writer. I remember how he used to sign off of telephone calls. Bless you. How he wept when he learned that my first daughter had been born. How he quoted Kipling right before he died, just like my grandfather. How he got me to smuggle him Marlboros, and I felt guilty afterward. I remember that we were together on 9/11, watching the TV footage, and how he didn't try to say anything smart about it. He just grieved. I remember the mole on his face and the expressiveness of his eyebrows. How his sister drove from South Carolina to Lexington for his funeral and looked so much like him that people said it must be Guy in drag. I remember how angry he'd get if I went for too long without calling. Reading his work is a way of communing or communicating with him. Welcome into the labyrinth of Davenport's learning and imagination. It is a unique one, insofar as you never get out of it, but are glad of it. John Jeremiah Sullivan, 2023. The Geography of the Imagination. The difference between the Parthenon and the World Trade Center, between a French wine glass and a German beer mug, between Bach and John Philip Sousa, between Sophocles and Shakespeare, between a bicycle and a horse, though explicable by historical moment, necessity, and destiny, is before all a difference of imagination. Man was first a hunter and an artist. His earliest vestiges tell us that alone. But he must always have dreamed and recognized and guessed and supposed, all skills of the imagination. Language itself is continuously an imaginative act. Rational discourse outside our familiar territory of Greek logic sounds to our ears like the wildest imagination. The Dogon, a people of West Africa, will tell you that a white fox named Ogo frequently weaves himself a hat of string bean hulls, puts it on his impudent head, and dances in the okra to insult and infuriate God Almighty, and that there's nothing we can do about it except abide him in faith and patience. This is not folklore or a quaint custom, but as serious a matter to the Dogon as a filling station to us Americans. The imagination, that is, the way we shape and use the world, indeed the way we see the world, has geographical boundaries like islands, continents, and countries. These boundaries can be crossed. That Dogon fox and his impudent dance came to live with us, but in a different body, and to serve a different mode of the imagination. We call him Br'er Rabbit. We in America are more sensitive than most to boundaries of the imagination. Our arrival was a second one. The misnamed first arrivers must still bear a name from the imagination of certain Renaissance men, who for almost a century could not break out of the notion that these two vast continents were the Indies, itself a name so vague as to include China, India, and even Turkey, for which they named our most delicious bird. The imagination has a history, as yet unwritten, and it has a geography, as yet only dimly seen. History and geography are inextricable disciplines. They have different shelves in the library and different offices at the university, but they cannot get along for a minute without consulting the other. Geography is the wife of history, as space is the wife of time. When Heraclitus said that everything passes steadily along, he was not inciting us to make the best of the moment, an idea unseemly to his placid mind, but to pay attention to the pace of things. Each has its own rhythm. The nap of a dog, the procession of the equinoxes, the dances of Lydia, the majestically slow beat of the drums at Dodona, the swift runners at Olympia. The imagination, like all things in time, is metamorphic. It is also rooted in a ground, a geography. The Latin word for the sacredness of a place is cultus, the dwelling of a god, the place where a rite is valid. Cultus becomes our word culture, not in the portentous sense it now has, but in a much humbler sense. For ancient people, the sacred was the vernacular ordinariness of things. The hearth, primarily. The bed, the wall around the yard. The temple was too sacred to be entered. Washing the feet of a guest was as religious an act as sharing one's meals with the gods. When Europeans came to the New World, they learned nothing on the way, as if they came through a dark tunnel. Plymouth, Lisbon, Amsterdam, then the rolling Atlantic for 3 months, then the rocks and pines, sand and palms of Carthay, the Indies, the wilderness. A German cartographer working in Paris decided to translate the first name of Amerigo Vespucci into Latin, for reasons best known to himself, and call the whole thing America. In geography, you have maps, and maps must have the names of places on them. We New World settlers, then, brought the imagination of other countries to transplant it in a different geography. We have been here scarcely a quarter of the time that the pharaohs ruled Egypt. We brought many things across the Atlantic and the Pacific, many things we left behind, a critical choice to live with forever. The imagination is like the drunk man who lost his watch and must get drunk again to find it. It is as intimate as speech and custom, and to trace its ways, we need to re-educate our eyes. In 1840, when Cooper's The Pathfinder was a bestseller and photography had just been made practical, an essay called The Philosophy of Furniture appeared in an American magazine. Dickens made fun of Americans for attending lectures on the philosophy of anything, the philosophy of crime on Monday, the philosophy of government on Wednesday, the philosophy of the soul on Thursday, as Martin Chuzzlewit learned from Mrs. Brick. The English also, we know from Thomas Love Peacock's satirical novels, were addicted to the lecture. The great French encyclopedia, its imitators, and the periodical press had done their work, and audiences were eager to hear anybody on any subject. Crowds attended the lectures of Louis Agassiz on zoology and geology. In 1840, he was explaining the Ice Age and the nature of glaciers, which he had just discovered. Of Emerson, of transcendentalists, utopians, homegrown scientists like John Cleve Sims of Cincinnati, who explained that the globe is open at the poles and another world and another humanity resident on the concavity of a hollow earth, and even Thoreau, who gave lectures in the basements of churches. The philosophy of furniture was by an unlikely writer, Edgar Allan Poe. In it, he explains how rooms should be decorated. "We have no aristocracy of the blood," says this author, who was educated at a university founded by Thomas Jefferson, "and having therefore as a natural and indeed as an inevitable thing, fashioned for ourselves an aristocracy of dollars, The display of wealth has here to take the place and perform the office of the heraldic display in monarchical countries. We are familiar with Poe's anxiety about good taste, about the fidelity of the United States to European models. What we want to see in this essay is a clue to the structure of Poe's imagination, which Charles Baudelaire thought the greatest of the century. An imagination so fine that Paul Valéry said it was incapable of making a mistake. Poe's sense of good taste in decoration was in harmony with the best English style of the early Victorian period. We recognize his ideal room as one in which we might find the young Carlyles, those strenuous aesthetes, or George Eliot and Elizabeth Gaskell. A glory of wallpaper, figured rugs, marble-top tables, tall narrow windows with dark red curtains, sofas, antimacassars, vases, unfading wax flowers under bell jars, a rosewood piano, and a cozy fireplace. The amazing thing is that Poe emphasizes lightness and grace, color and clarity. Whereas we associate his imagination with the most claustrophobic, dark, Gothic interiors in all of literature. On our walls, Poe says, we should have many paintings to relieve the expanse of wallpaper. A glossy paper of silver-gray tint, spotted with small arabesque devices of a fainter hue. These are, he dictates, chiefly landscapes of an imaginative cast, such as the fairy grottos of Stanfield, or the lake of the dismal swamp of Chapman. There are, nevertheless, three or four female heads of an ethereal beauty, portraits in the manner of Sully. In another evocation of an ideal room, in a sketch called Landor's Cottage, he again describes a wall with pictures. Three of Julien's exquisite lithographs à trois crayons fastened to the wall without frames. One of these drawings was a scene of Oriental luxury, or rather, voluptuousness. Another was a carnival piece, spirited beyond compare. The third was a Greek female head, a face so divinely beautiful, and yet of an expression so provokingly indeterminate, never before arrested my attention. Poe titled the collection of his stories published that year, Tales of the Grotesque and Arabesque. These two adjectives have given critics trouble for years. Grotesque, as Poe found it in the writings of Sir Walter Scott, means something close to Gothic, an adjective designating the Goths and their architecture, and what the neoclassical 18th century thought of medieval art in general, that it was ugly but grand. It was the fanciful decoration by the Italians of grottos or caves with shells, and statues of ogres and giants from the realm of legend, that gave the word grotesque its meaning of freakish, monstrous, misshapen. Arabesque clearly means the intricate, non-representational, infinitely graceful decorative style of Islam, best known to us in their carpets, the geometric tile work of their mosques, and their calligraphy. Had Poe wanted to designate the components of his imagination more accurately, his title would have been Tales of the Grotesque, Arabesque, and Classical. For Poe, in all his writing, divided all his imagery up into three distinct species. Look back at the pictures on the wall in his ideal rooms. In one we have grottos and a view of the dismal swamp. This is the grotesque mode. Then female heads in the manner of Sully. This is the classical mode. The wallpaper against which they hang is arabesque. In the other room, we had a scene of Oriental luxury, the arabesque. A carnival piece, spirited beyond compare. Poe means masked and costumed people at Mardi Gras, as in the Cask of Amontillado and the Mask of the Red Death. The grotesque. And a Greek female head, the classical. A thorough inspection of Poe's work will disclose that he performs variations and mutations of these three vocabularies of imagery. We can readily recognize those works in which a particular idiom is dominant. The great octosyllabic sonnet to Helen, for instance, is classical. The Fall of the House of Usher is grotesque, and the poem Israfel is arabesque. But no work is restricted to one mode. The other two are there also. We all know the beautiful To Helen, written when he was still a boy. Helen, thy beauty is to me like those Nicaean barks of yore, that gently o'er a perfumed sea the weary, way-worn wanderer bore to his own native shore. On desperate seas long wont to roam, thy hyacinth hair, thy classic face, thy naiad airs have brought me home to the glory that was Greece and the grandeur that was Rome. Lo, in yon brilliant window niche, how statue-like I see thee stand, the agate lamp within thy hand. Ah, Psyche, from the regions which are holy land. The words are as magic as Keats, but what is the sense? Sappho, whom Poe is imitating, had compared a woman's beauty to a fleet of ships. Byron had previously written lines that Poe out-Byrons Byron with, in The Glory That Was Greece and The Grandeur That Was Rome. But how is Helen also Psyche? Who is the wanderer coming home? Scholars are not sure. In fact, the poem is not easy to defend against the strictures of critics. We can point out that Nicaean is not, as has been charged, a pretty bit of gibberish, but the adjective for the city of Nice, where a major shipworks was. Mark Antony's fleet was built there. We can defend perfumed sea, which has been called silly, by noting that classical ships never left sight of land and could smell orchards on shore, that perfumed oil was an extensive industry in classical times, and that ships laden with it would smell better than your shipload of sheep. Poe is normally far more exact than he is given credit for. That window niche, however, slipped in from Northern Europe. It is Gothic, a slight tone of the grotto in this almost wholly classical poem. And the closing words, Holy Land, belong to the Levant, to the Arabesque. In The Raven, we have a dominant grotesque key, with a vision of an Arabesque Eden, perfumed from an unseen censer, swung by seraphim whose footfalls tinkled on the tufted floor. And a grotesque raven sits on a classical bust of Pallas Athena. That raven was the device on the flag of Alaric the Visigoth, whose torch at Eleusis was the beginning of the end of Pallas's reign over the mind of man. Lenore, a name Walter Scott brought from Germany for his horse, is a mutation of Eleanor, a French mutation of Helen. Were we to follow the metamorphoses of these images through all of Poe, grotesque or Gothic, arabesque or Islamic, classical or Greco-Roman, we would discover an articulate grammar of symbols, a new, as yet unread Poe. What we shall need to understand is the meaning of the symbols, and why they are constantly being translated from one imagistic idiom to another. The clues are not difficult, or particularly arcane. Israfel, for instance, is an arabesque, and Roderick Usher a grotesque Orpheus. Orpheus himself does not appear in Poe in his native Greek self. But once we see Orpheus in Usher, we can then see that this masterpiece is a retelling of his myth from a point of view informed by a modern understanding of neuroses, of the inexplicable perverseness of the human will. That lute, that speaking guitar, all those books on Usher's table about journeys underground and rites held in darkness, all fit into a translation by Poe of a classical text into a Gothic one. The gold bug, as Northrop Frye has seen, is strangely like the marriage of Danae. The old black who lowers the gold bug is named Jupiter. Danae was shut up in a treasure house, and a riddle put her there. Where do these images come from? The Mediterranean in the time of Columbus was from its western end and along its northern shore Greco-Roman, what the historians call the Latin culture, and at its eastern end and along its southern shore, Islamic. So two-thirds of Poe's triple imagery sums up the Mediterranean and fed his imagination with its most congenial and rich portion. The Gothic style has its home in northern Europe, my Germany of the soul, as Poe put it. He was always ambiguous about the culture with which, ironically, he is identified. Death, corruption, and dreariness inhere in the Gothic. Poe relates it to melancholia, hypersensitivity, madness, obsession, awful whirlpools in the cold sea, ancient houses spent and crumbling. Is there some pattern here from his own life? There is a real House of Usher, still standing, not in a gloomy Transylvanian valley by a black tarn, but in Boston, Massachusetts, where Poe was born, and where his barely remembered mother played the first Ophelia on an American stage, a role definitively Gothic in Poe's scheme of modes. Poe's sense of Islam, which we can trace to Byron and Shelley, derived as well from the explorers Burckhardt, Volney, and John Lloyd Stevens. The angel Israfel is not, as Poe wants us to believe, in the Quran, but from George Sale's introduction to his translation of the Quran by way of Thomas More. The classical was being restated before Poe's eyes in Charlottesville by an old man who said he loved a particular Greek temple, as if it were his mistress. Jefferson had the undergraduates up to dinner at Monticello two at a time, in alphabetical order. P is deep in the alphabet. Poe was expelled, and the old man dead, before the two most astute readers of Alexander von Humboldt in the United States could face each other over a platter of Virginia ham. Poe's imagination was perfectly at home in geographies he had no knowledge of, except what his imagination appropriated from other writers. We might assume, in ignorance, that he knew Paris like a Parisian, that Italy and Spain were familiar to him, and even Antarctica, and the face of the moon. The brothers Goncourt wrote in their journal, as early as 1856, that Poe was a new kind of man, writing a new kind of literature. We have still to learn that his sensibility was radically intelligent rather than emotional. When he compares the eyes of Ligeia to stars, they are the binary stars that Herschel discovered and explained in the year of Poe's birth, the spectroscopic double Beta Lyra and the double-double Epsilon Lyra, to be exact, not the generalized stars of Petrarchan tradition. We have paid too little attention to this metaphysical Poe, and we scarcely understand Europeans when they speak of the passion they find in his poetry. What are we to think of the Russian translator of Poe, Vladimir Piast, who, while reciting Ulalum in a St. Petersburg theater, went stark raving mad? Russians treasure the memory of that evening. Night after night, from 1912 to 1917, a man who might have been the invention of Poe sat in a long, almost empty room in a working-class district of Berlin, writing a book by candlelight. Might have been the invention of Poe. He was basically a classicist. His doctoral thesis was on Heraclitus. His mind was shaped by Goethe, Nietzsche, von Humboldt, and Leo Frobenius, the anthropologist and cultural morphologist. Like Poe, he thought in symbols. He was Oswald Spengler. His big book, The Decline of the West, was meant to parallel the military campaigns of the Wehrmacht in 1914 to 1918, which by pedantic adherence to tactics and heroic fervor was to impose German regularity and destiny upon Europe. Spengler's book, like the Wehrmacht, imposed only a tragic sense that history is independent of our will, ironically perverse, and a nightmare. The value of The Decline of the West is in its poetry of vision, its intuition of the rise, growth, and decline of cultures. By culture, Spengler meant the formative energy of a people, lasting for thousands of years. A civilization is the maturity of a culture, and inevitably, its decline. His feeling for the effeteness of a finished culture was precisely that of Poe in The Fall of the House of Usher and The Murders in the Rue Morgue, both stories about the vulnerability of order and civilized achievement. Spengler's most useful intuition was to divide world cultures into three major styles: the Apollonian, or Greco-Roman, the Faustian, or Western Northern European, and the Magian, or Asian and Islamic. Historians instantly complained that the cultures of our world may not be divided into three, but into 76 distinct groups. What interests us, however, is that Spengler's categories are exactly those of Edgar Allan Poe, and those of James Joyce. Consider the first three stories of Joyce's Dubliners. The first is concerned with a violation of rites that derive from deep in Latin culture by way of the Roman Mass. The second takes its symbols from chivalry, the moral codes of the Northern knighthood. And the third is named Araby. This triad of symbolic patterns is repeated four more times to achieve 15 stories. The first three chapters of Ulysses also follow this structure, even more complexly. And the simplest shape to which we can summarize Ulysses is to say that it is about a man, Leopold Bloom, in a Northern European, a Faustian technological context, who is by heritage a Jew of Spengler's Magian culture, who is made to act out the adventures of Ulysses, exemplar of classical man. "We have museum catalogues, but no artistic atlases," the great French historian and cultural geographer Fernand Braudel complains in his The Mediterranean and the Mediterranean World in the Age of Philip II. "We have histories of art and literature, but none of civilization." He suspects that such a map of the arts would disclose the same kind of historical structure that he has demonstrated for food, clothing, trade routes, industrial and banking centers, and that our understanding of our imaginative life would take on as yet unguessed coherence and hitherto uncomprehended behavior. Such a map would presumably display such phenomena as the contours of the worship of Demeter and Persephone coinciding with grain-producing terrain, and with the contours of Catholicism. This would not surprise us. It might also show how the structure of psychology and drama nourished by grain-producing cultures persists outside that terrain, continuing to act as if it were inside, because its imaginative authority refuses to abdicate. How else can we explain a story like O. Henry's The Church with the Overshot Wheel? In this poignant little tale, set in the pine woods of North Carolina, a miller's daughter named Aglaya, a name commensurate with the style of naming girls in the fancy names belt, is kidnapped by shiftless rovers who take her to Atlanta. The miller, in his grief, moves away to the Northwest, becomes prosperous and a philanthropist, naming his best brand of flour for his lost daughter, whom he supposes to be dead. In her memory, he has his old mill rebuilt as a church, endowing it handsomely, but keeping its overshot wheel. The community becomes a summer resort for people of modest means, and of course, O. Henry has the orphan daughter come to it as a grown woman, and in a typical denouement, her memory of a song she used to sing as a child, together with an accidental spill of flour over her father, who is visiting the old mill, reunites them. O. Henry, perhaps unconsciously, has retold the myth of Persephone, using a name, Aglaia, the bright girl, which was one of the epithets of Persephone, deification of wheat, and all the elements of the myth transposed to 20th century America. The rape that brought devastation, the return and reunion that brought healing and regeneration. I find an explanation of this story according to the theory of Jungian archetypes, patterns imprinted in the mind, unsatisfactory. It is better to trace O. Henry's plot and symbols backward along geographical lines, through myths brought across the Atlantic from the Mediterranean, through books and schoolrooms, through libraries and traditions, and to assess his history as a detail in the structure of a culture of strong vitality, which decided on the expressiveness of certain symbols 5,000 years ago, and finds them undiminished and still full of human significance. The appeal of popular literature must lie precisely in its faithfulness to ancient traditions. The charming little children's book by Carlo Collodi, Le Avventure di Pinocchio, can scarcely claim to be included in a history of Italian literature. And yet, to a geographer of the imagination, it is a more elegant paradigm of the narrative art of the Mediterranean than any other book since Ovid's Metamorphoses, rehearses all the central myths, and adds its own to the rich stock of its tradition. It reaches back to a Gnostic theme known to both Shakespeare and Emily Dickinson. "Split the stick," said Jesus, "and I am there." It combines Pygmalion, Ovid, the Book of Jonah, the Commedia dell'arte, and Apuleius, and will continue to be a touchstone of the imagination. The discovery of America, its settlement, and economic development were activities of the Renaissance and the Reformation, Mediterranean tradition, and Northern acumen. The continuities of that double heritage have been long-lasting. The Pequod set out from Joppa. The first Thoreau was named Diogenes. Whitman is a contemporary of Socrates. The Spoon River Anthology was first written in Alexandria. For 30 years now, our greatest living writer, Eudora Welty, has been rewriting Ovid in Mississippi. The Jumping Frog of Calaveras County was a turn for a 5th-century Athenian mime. A geography of the imagination would extend the shores of the Mediterranean all the way to Iowa. Eldon, Iowa, where in 1929 Grant Wood sketched a farmhouse as the background for a double portrait of his sister Nan and his dentist, Dr. B.H. McKeeby, who donned overalls for the occasion and held a rake. Forces that arose 3 millennia ago in the Mediterranean changed the rake to a pitchfork, as we shall see. Let us discuss this painting, to which we are blinded by familiarity and parody. In the remotest distance against this perfect blue of a fine harvest sky, there is the Gothic spire of a country church, as if to seal the Protestant sobriety and industry of the subjects. Next, there are trees, 7 of them, as along the porch of Solomon's temple, symbols of prudence and wisdom. Next, still reading from background to foreground, is the house that gives the primary meaning of the title American Gothic, a style of architecture. It is an example of a revolution in domestic building that made possible the rapid rise of American cities after the Civil War and dotted the prairies with decent, neat farmhouses. It is what was first called in derision a balloon frame house, so easy to build that a father and his son could put it up. It is an elegant geometry of light timber posts and rafters requiring no deep foundation, and is nailed together. Technically, it is, like the clothes of the farmer and his wife, a mail-order house, as the design comes out of a pattern book, this one from those of Alexander Davis and Andrew Downing, the architects who modified details of the Gothic revival for American farmhouses. The balloon frame house was invented in Chicago in 1833 by George Washington Snow, who was orchestrating in his invention a century of mechanization that provided the nails, wire screen, sash windows, tin roof, lathe-turned posts for the porch, doorknobs, locks, and hinges, all standard pieces from factories. We can see a bamboo sunscreen, out of China by way of Sears Roebuck, that rolls up like a sail. Nautical technology applied to the prairie. We can see that distinctly American feature, the screen door. The sash windows are European in origin, their glass panes from Venetian technology as perfected by the English, a luxury that was a marvel of the 18th century, and now as common as the farmer's spectacles, another revolution in technology that would have seemed a miracle to previous ages. Spectacles begin in the 13th century, the invention of either Salvino degli Armati or Alessandro della Spina. The first portrait of a person wearing specs is of Cardinal Ugone di Provenza in a fresco of 1352 by Tommaso Barisino di Modena. We might note, as we are trying to see the geographical focus that this painting gathers together, that the center for lens grinding, from which eyeglasses diffused to the rest of civilization, was the same part of Holland from which the style of the painting itself derives. Another 13th century invention, prominent in our painting, is the buttonhole. Buttons themselves are prehistoric, but they were shoulder fasteners that engaged with loops. Modern clothing begins with the buttonhole. The farmer's wife secures her Dutch Calvinist collar with a cameo brooch, an heirloom passed down the generations, an 18th century or Victorian copy of a design that goes back to the 6th century BC. She is a product of the ages, this modest Iowa farm wife. She has the hairdo of a medieval Madonna, a Reformation collar, a Greek cameo, a 19th century pinafore. Martin Luther put her a step behind her husband. John Knox squared her shoulders. The stock market crash of 1929 put that look in her eyes. The train that brought her clothes, paper pattern, bolt cloth, needle, thread, scissors, also brought her husband's bib overalls, which were originally in the 1870s trainmen's work clothes designed in Europe, manufactured here for J.C. Penney, and disseminated across the United States as the railroads connected city with city. The cloth is denim, from Nîmes in France, introduced by Levi Strauss of blue jean fame. The design can be traced to no less a person than Herbert Spencer, who thought he was creating a utilitarian one-piece suit for everybody to wear. His own example was of tweed, with buttons from crotch to neck, and his female relatives somehow survived the mortification of his sporting it one Sunday in St. James's Park. His jacket is the modification of that of a Scots shepherd, which we all still wear. Grant Wood's Iowans stand, as we might guess, in a pose dictated by the Brownie box camera, close together in front of their house, the farmer looking at the lens with solemn honesty, his wife with modestly averted eyes. But that will not account for the pitchfork, held as assertively as a Minuteman's rifle. The pose is rather that of the Egyptian Prince Rahotep, holding the flail of Osiris, beside his wife Nufrit, strict with pious rectitude, poised in absolute dignity, mediators between heaven and earth, givers of grain, obedient to the gods. This formal pose lasts out 3,000 years of Egyptian history, passes to some of the classical cultures, Etruscan couples in terracotta, for instance, but does not attract Greece and Rome. It recommences in northern Europe, where, to the dismay of the Romans, Gaulish wives rode beside their husbands in the war chariot. Kings, and eventually the merchants of the North, repeated the Egyptian double portrait of husband and wife. Van Eyck's Meister and Frau Arnolfini, Rubens and his wife Helena. It was this Netherlandish tradition of painting middle-class folk with honor and precision that turned Grant Wood from Montparnasse, where he spent 2 years in the 1920s trying to be an American post-impressionist, back to Iowa, to be our Hans Memling. If Van Gogh could ask, "Where is my Japan?" and be told by Toulouse-Lautrec that it was Provence, Wood asked himself the whereabouts of his Holland, and found it in Iowa. Just 30 years before Wood's painting, Edwin Markham's poem, The Man with the Hoe, had pictured the farmer as a peasant with a life scarcely different from that of an ox, and called on the working men of the world to unite, as they had nothing to lose but their chains. The painting that inspired Markham was one of a series of agricultural subjects by Jean-François Millet, whose work also inspired Van Gogh. A digging fork appears in 5 of Van Gogh's pictures, 3 of them variations on themes by Millet, and all of them are studies of grinding labor and poverty. And yet, the independent farmer had edged out the idle aristocrat for the hand of the girl in Royal Tyler's The Contrast, the first Native American comedy for the stage. And in Emerson's Concord Hymn, it is a battle line of farmers who fire the shot heard around the world. George III, indeed, referred to his American colonies as the farms, and the two Georges of the Revolution, Hanover and Washington, were proudly farmers by etymology and in reality. The window curtains and apron in this painting are both calico printed in a reticular design, the curtains of rhombuses, the apron of circles and dots. The configuration Sir Thomas Browne traced through nature and art in his Garden of Cyrus, the quincuncial arrangement of trees in orchards, perhaps the first human imitation of phyllotaxis, acknowledging the symmetry, justice, and divine organization of nature. Curtains and aprons are as old as civilization itself, but their presence here in Iowa implies a cotton mill, dye works, a roller press that prints calico, and a wholesale retail distribution system involving a post office, a train, its tracks, and, in short, the Industrial Revolution. That revolution came to America in the astounding memory of one man, Samuel Slater, who arrived in Philadelphia in 1789 with the plans of all Arkwright's, Crompton's, and Hargreaves's machinery in his head, put himself at the service of the rich Quaker Moses Brown, and built the first American factory at Pawtucket, Rhode Island. The apron is trimmed with rickrack ribbon, a machine-made substitute for lace. The curtains are bordered in a variant of the egg and dart design that comes from Nabatea, the biblical Edom in Syria, a design which the architect Hiram incorporated into the entablatures of Solomon's temple. And the chapiters upon the two pillars had pomegranates also above, over against the belly which was by the network. And the pomegranates were 200 in rows round about. 1 Kings chapter 7, verse 20. And which formed the border of the high priest's dress, a frieze of pomegranates of blue and of purple and of scarlet, around about the hem thereof, and bells of gold between them round about. Exodus chapter 28, verse 33. The brass button that secures the farmer's collar is an unassertive, puritanical understatement of Matthew Bolton's 18th-century cut-steel button made in the factory of James Watt. His shirt button is mother-of-pearl, made by James Beppel from Mississippi freshwater mussel shell, and his jacket button is of South American vegetable ivory, passing for horn. The farmer and his wife are attended by cymbals, she by 2 plants on the porch, a potted geranium and sansevieria, both tropical and alien to Iowa. He by the three-tined American pitchfork, whose triune shape is repeated throughout the painting, in the bib of the overalls, the windows, the faces, the siding of the house, to give it a formal organization of impeccable harmony. If this painting is primarily a statement about Protestant diligence on the American frontier, carrying in its style and subject a wealth of information about imported technology, psychology, and aesthetics, it still does not turn away from a pervasive cultural theme of Mediterranean origin, a tension between the growing and the ungrowing, between vegetable and mineral, organic and inorganic, wheat and iron. Transposed back into its native geography, this icon of the Lord of Metals with his iron scepter, head wreathed with glass and silver, buckled in tin and brass, and a chaste bride, who has already taken on the metallic thraldom of her plight in the gold ovals of her hair and brooch, are Dis and Persephone posed in a royal portrait among the attributes of the first Mediterranean Trinity. Zeus in the blue sky and lightning rod, Poseidon in the trident of the pitchfork, Hades in the metals. It is a picture of a sheaf of golden grain, female and cyclical, perennial and the mother of civilization, and of metal shaped into scythe and hoe, nature and technology, earth and farmer, man and world, and their achievement together. The symbol of the archaic. 4 years ago, there was discovered near Sarla in the Dordogne the rib of an ox on which some hunter engraved with a flint burin 70 lines depicting we know not what, some god, some animal schematically drawn, a map, the turning of the seasons, the mensurations of the moon. We have found in this lovely part of France many such prehistoric artifacts, carved bones, mysterious scepters, rocks written over with lunar counts and seasonal notations, and decorated with salmon, reindeer, and seals, the lines of which are worn faint from being carried for ages in the hands of hunters. Many of these objects, the engraving of which is not in the least primitive or unsophisticated, are 50 millennia old. The ox rib found at Sarla was published before a learned community in Toronto by Alexander Marshak in a paper given to the American Anthropological Association in December 1972. Professor Hallam Movius, professor emeritus at the Peabody Museum of Archaeology and Ethnology, Harvard, and a protege of l'Abbé Henri Breuil, the most distinguished of prehistorians, believes it to be 100,000 years old. Alexander Marshak, whose reading of prehistoric notation, the roots of civilization, is as brilliant and surprising as that of André Leroy Gourand, Treasures of Prehistoric Art, dates the Sarla ox rib at 135,000 years, and its discoverer, François Bord, director of the Laboratory of Prehistory at the University of Bordeaux, places it at 230,000. It is man's oldest known work of art, or plat of hunting rights, tax receipt, star map, or whatever it is. Just a little over a century ago, John William Bergen, then an undergraduate at Worcester College, Oxford, wrote a poem about the desert city Petra, which the traveler Johann Ludwig Burckhardt had come upon 30 years before. Except for these magic lines, much anthologized, the poem has been forgotten, along with its poet. Not saintly gray, like many a minister fain that crowns the hill or sanctifies the plain, but rosy red, as if the blush of dawn which first beheld them were not yet withdrawn. The hues of youth upon a brow of woe, which men called old 2,000 years ago. Match me such marvel, save in eastern clime, a rose-red city, half as old as time. Shelley had put Petra in a poem as soon as Burckhardt discovered it. It is one of the places the wandering youth visits in Alastor. The others are taken from Volney's Les Ruines, 1791, which had also inspired Queen Mab and The Demon of the World. Bergen, stealing half a line from Samuel Rogers's Italy, makes Petra half as old as time, for creation was still an event dated 4004 BC. The 18th century taught us to look at ruins with a particular frisson, to thrill to the depths of years in which we can stand. Volney at Persepolis and Palmyra, Gibbon in the Colosseum, Champollion at Thebes, Schliemann at Hisarlik, and Mycenae were as symbolic of the attention of their age as command pilot Neil Armstrong on the moon of ours. The discovery of the physical past generated a deep awe and romantic melancholy, positing a new vocabulary of images for poetry. Petra, carved in red Nabataean stone, became an image resonant with meaning. Without its name, and with a sharper angst than romantic wonder, it can still move us in Eliot's evocation in The Wasteland. You know only a heap of broken images where the sun beats and the dead tree gives no shelter, the cricket no relief, and the dry stone no sound of water. Only there is shadow under this red rock. Come in under the shadow of this red rock. From the visits in 1678 and 1691 of English merchants to Palmyra, which they supposed to be the biblical Tadmor, providing Gibbon with a skeptical footnote, Thomas Love Peacock with a fashion-setting poem, and the romantic poetry of Europe with a new kind of image, to the present diligent science of archaeology, a meditation on ruins has been a persistent theme. In our time, we have Charles Olson's The Kingfishers, the central poem in the projectivist school of poets, and a meditation on ruins, demonstrating that the form is far from exhausted. It is even Volney-esque, and for all Olson's stringent modernity, can be read as an inquiry into the rise and fall of civilizations that continues a subject taken up in the earliest days of Romanticism. Like his master Pound, Olson sees civilizations grow and perish against a continuum of nature, though he is modern enough to know that nature's moment are not really eternal. They are simply much longer than those of civilizations. Nature herself has her ruins, deserts, and flooded lands. Olson was writing poems about the drift of continents when he died. Olson's The Kingfishers was inspired in part by Pablo Neruda's Alturas de Machu Picchu, a masterpiece among poems about ruins by a traveled poet who had been to Angkor Wat and the Athenian Acropolis, Yucatan and Cusco. At the heart of Olson's poem is the E on that oldest stone, meaning the epsilon on the Omphalos stone at Delphi, which Plutarch puzzled over at the behest of Nero. We are still not certain whether it is part of the word Gea, earth, or part of a Greek citizen's name. Plutarch, always willing to be Pythagorean, gives many symbolic explanations, but for Olson, the import of that conical, ancient stone was precisely that it is so ancient that we have lost the meaning of the writing upon it. When we discover what it means, we will still be dissociated forever from the complex of ideas in which it occurs. And that is the center of Olson's concern in this poem, that culture is both historically and geographically discrete. We are alien, Olson said, from everything that was most familiar. This is a random statement from his late inarticulate lectures, and like so many of the poet's Delphic utterances, lies unexplained in a tangle of non sequiturs. Perhaps he felt that it was already elaborated by poets as different as Keats and Rimbaud, who had intuitions of a deep past which we have sacrificed for a tawdry and impious present. By Neruda and Prescott, men appalled by the brutality with which the indigenous cultures of the Americas were murdered. Olson was writing his poem while Europe still lay in ruins from the Second World War. Olson was a poet with a frightening sense of where he was in time. He was one of the most original explicators of Melville, whose Clarel is among the great, and greatly neglected, meditations on ruins. Of Christianity as well as of cultures which he suspected might have found more congenial than his own, if mankind had allowed them to survive. And whose Moby Dick was Olson's model for his vision of the long continuum of nature, the majesty of which belittles the diminutive empires of man. Man, whose bulk is 1/1250th of that of a whale, whose lifespan is 1/3 of that of a goose, and whose advantages over his fellow creatures are all mechanical, and therefore dependent on the education of each generation. Meaning that an intervening generation of barbarians destroys all that has been carefully accumulated for centuries. The unit of civilization is the city. The classical ages knew this so well that they scarcely alluded to it intellectually. Emotionally, it was a fact which they honored with rites and a full regalia of symbols. The city appeared on their coins as a goddess crowned with battlements. She was the old grain goddess, Cybele Demeter, and it is clear that ancient men thought of the city as a culmination of a process that began among the cityless hunters who learned to pen cattle and live in the enclosure with them, who developed agriculture, the goddess's second gift after the bounty of the animals, and made the city a focus of farms and roads. About the time the Romantic poets were being most eloquent about ruined cities, the city itself was undergoing a profound change. The railroad was about to cancel the identity of each city, making them all into ports of trade, into warehouses and markets. Eliot's Wasteland, Joyce's Ulysses, Pound's Cantos, Bielli's Petersburg, all epics of the city appear at the same time as the automobile, the machine that stole the city's rationale for being, and made us all gypsies and barbarians, camping in the ruins of the one unit of civilization which man has thus far evolved. The city lasted from Jericho, Harappa, and the Chattahoochee to its ruin in Paterson, New Jersey, as one poet specified, from Troy to Dublin, Joyce's long chord. Pound, in the Cantos, makes another chord of meaning with the beginning and end of Venice, Europe's first outpost against the barbarians. All of this is part of what Olson meant by saying that we are alienated from all that was most familiar. Basically, he meant that we no longer milk the cow, or shoot the game for our dinner, or make our clothes, or houses, or anything at all. Secondly, he meant that we have drained our symbols of meaning. We hang religious pictures in museums, honoring a residual meaning in them at least. We have divorced poetry from music, language from concrete particulars. We have abandoned the rite de passage to casual neglect, where once we marked them with trial and ceremony. Thirdly, he meant that modernity is a kind of stupidity, as it has no critical roots for analyzing reality, such as the ancient cultures kept bright and sharp. We do not notice that we are ruled by the worst rather than the best of men. Olson took over a word coined by Pound, pejorocracy. Poetry and fiction have grieved for a century now over the loss of some vitality which they think they see in a past from which we are by now irrevocably alienated. Joyce found in Vico cause to believe that Western civilization is at an end. Olson felt with Mao Zedong that the new vitality will come from the East. Pound considered us to be in a blank hiatus between cultures. So did Yeats, and perhaps Eliot. D.H. Lawrence looked for restorative forces deep in blood and genitals, longing for the color and robustness of the Etruscans. All this pessimism and backward yearning has usually been counterbalanced and complemented by a kind of fulfillment. For in any characterization of the arts in our time, we shall always want to say that if we have had a renaissance in the 20th century, it has been a renaissance of the archaic. Every age has had its sense of archaic time, usually mythological, usually at variance with its history. It is man's worst ineptitude that he has not remembered his own past. Another way of saying this is that only at certain moments in cultures does man's past have any significance to him. Go back to the Sarla bone, possibly 230,000 years old, with which we began. What would it have looked like to a 17th century antiquarian? John Aubrey, we remember, thought Stonehenge to be the ruins of a Roman temple, and his patron Charles was satisfied with this information. When the Abbé Breuil petitioned UNESCO for funds after the Second World War to study the 20,000-year-old paintings in the Lascaux cave near Montignac, discovered in 1940 by Jacques Marsal's dog, Robot, who was chasing a rabbit, UNESCO refused, on the grounds that the paintings were obviously fraudulent. Breuil had encountered the same incredulity for 40 years. There was, however, a silent believer from the beginning of his career who saw prehistoric art with eyes which would influence all other eyes in our time. When Breuil was copying the ceiling of bulls in the Spanish cave Altamira, a young man from Barcelona crawled in beside him and marveled at the beauty of the painting, at the energy of the designs. He would in a few years teach himself to draw with similar energy and primal clarity, and would incorporate one of these enigmatic bulls into his largest painting, the Guernica. He was Pablo Picasso. If we say, as we can, that the archaic is one of the great inventions of the 20th century, we mean that as the first European Renaissance looked back to Hellenistic Rome for a range of models and symbols, the 20th century has looked back to a deeper past, in which it has imagined it sees the very beginnings of civilization. The Laocoon was Michelangelo's touchstone. The red stone Kouros from Sunian was Picasso's. What is most modern in our time frequently turns out to be the most archaic. The sculpture of Brancusi belongs to the art of the Cyclades in the 9th century BC. Corbusier's buildings in their cubist phase look like the white clay houses of Anatolia and Malta. Plato and Aristotle somehow mislaid the tetrahedron from among Pythagoras's basic geometric figures. Recovered by R. Buckminster Fuller, the tetrahedron turns out to be the basic building block of the universe. Pythagoras said that where two lines cross, the junction is two lines thick. Euclid said that lines can cross infinitely without any thickness at all. R. Buckminster Fuller constructs his tensegrities and geodesic domes with the firm notion that at their junction, crossed lines are two lines thick. Fuller, then, is our Pythagoras. Niels Bohr is our Democritus. Ludwig Wittgenstein is our Heraclitus. There is nothing quite so modern as a page of any of the pre-Socratic physicists, where science and poetry are still the same thing, and where the modern mind feels a kinship it no longer has with Aquinas, or even Newton. Ethos anthropi daimon, said Heraclitus, which may mean that our moral nature is a daimon, or guiding spirit from among the purified souls of the dead. Or it may be utterly primitive and mean that the weather is a god. Character, our Buckminster Fuller seems to translate it, is prevailing wind. Pound, time is the evil. Novalis, character is fate. Wyndham Lewis, the zeitgeist is a demon. Wittgenstein was paraphrasing it when he said, as if he were an Erewhonian, character is physique. In Heraclitus, our most representative writers discovered a spirit congenial to their predicament as modern men. The neo-Epicurean philosopher Gassendi revived him. Nietzsche admired the elemental transparency of his thought, and we can now find him as a genius loci everywhere. In Hopkins, Spengler, Pound, William Carlos Williams, Eliot, Olson, Gertrude Stein. It is not entirely Heraclitus's intuitive fusion of science and poetry that has made a modern philosopher of him. It is also his primacy in Western thought. He has lasted. The heart of the modern taste for the archaic is precisely the opposite of the romantic feeling for ruins. Heraclitus, like the paintings at Lascaux, like the eloquent fragments of Sappho and Archilochus, has survived and thus become timeless. Picasso liked to say that modern art is what we have kept. To his eyes, Brancusi was cycladic. Stravinsky in the Sacre du Printemps was a primitive Russian. Conversely, the bisque-colored, black-maned, prancing tarpan of Lascaux, the very definition of archaic painting, is one of the most characteristic works of 20th century art. For quite literally, ours are the first eyes to see it ever. It was painted in the deep dark of a cave by torchlight, an uncertainty to the man or woman who painted it. The best way to see it has always been as a color reproduction in a book, and now this is the only way to see it. 20 years of tourists' breaths caused bacteria to grow in the paint. And Lascaux, the most beautiful of the prehistoric caves, has been closed forever. It has taken half the century for modern eyes to see the archaic. Cocteau dated this aesthetic adjustment from the year 1910, when Guillaume Apollinaire placed a Benin mask on his wall. Suddenly, an image both ugly and disturbing, still bearing the name fetish, which the Portuguese exploiters of Africa had given it, became a work of art, which could hang in a museum beside a Hogarth or Rembrandt. Apollinaire was not all that original. He was taking his cue from the German anthropologist Leo Frobenius, who had begun to argue that African art was neither primitive nor naive. It was simply the African style. Even before Apollinaire broadened his vision to see the sophistication and beauty of African art, the French sculptor Henri Gaudier-Bjeska had also read his Frobenius and was working in styles derived from Polynesia, Egypt, and ancient China. All he required of a style was that it be archaic, that is, in the primal stage of its formation. For Gaudier and his friend Pound had conceived the notion that cultures awake with a brilliant springtime and move through seasonal developments to a decadence. This is an idea from Frobenius, who had it from Spengler, who had it from Nietzsche, who had it from Goethe. Archaic art, then, was springtime art in any culture. We can now see how Pound proceeded to study and imitate the earliest Greek poetry, the earliest Italian, the earliest Chinese. Pound culminated his long career by translating the Chinese Book of Odes, the first poems of which are archaic folk songs collected by Confucius. And consider Canto 1. It is a translation of the most archaic part of the Odyssey, the descent of Odysseus into Hades, a motif that goes all the way back to the Gilgamesh epic. And how does Pound translate it? Not from the Greek, but from the Latin of Andreas Divus, the first Renaissance translator of Homer, thereby working another archaic fact into his symbol. And into what kind of English does he translate it? Into the rhythms and diction of the seafarer and the wanderer, archaic English. The modern grasp of the archaic happened first not in the appreciation of modern art, but in the attempt to recover the archaic genius of the language itself, in the sense William Barnes and Frederick James Furnival developed of a pure mother English, which would eschew Latinisms and Renaissance coinages, a kind of linguistic pre-Raphaelitism that wanted to circumvent the Europeanization of English. The first fruits of this enthusiasm were Gerard Manley Hopkins, whose English is purer even than Spencer's, and the great unknown of English letters, Charles Montague Doughty, who suspected all writers after Chaucer of whoring after strange dictionaries, who went into the Arabian desert, or Garden of God, the most archaic act of modern literature, to save, as he said, the English language. That salvation is still one of the best of books, The Travels in Arabia Deserta, though we have neglected his masterpiece, The Dawn in Britain, with its archaic theme and its archaic English. When in Ulysses Joyce writes a chapter in English that evolves from its most archaic to the most modern and slangy styles, he conceals in his parody of Carlyle, the Victorian archaicist, the phrase, "A doughty deed, Purefoy," to let us know that he is keeping the faith. Joyce's rigorous sense of correspondences places him foremost, or at least alongside Picasso, in the century's equation of archaic and modern. Like Pound and Kazantzakis, he wrote his epic across the most ancient pages of Western literature, the Odyssey, and in Finnegan's Wake writes across the fact of the Indo-European origin of European languages, seeing in the kinship of tongues the great archaeological midden of history, the tragic incomprehensibility of which provides him with a picture of the funeral of Western culture. One sure principle of Finnegan's Wake is that it always holds in its puns the modern and the archaic. A street full of traffic is also a panorama of prehistoric places and animals. The Wall Hall's horrors of Rolls Rights, car hacks, Stonehenge's, kissed veins, tram trees, Fargo brawlers, autokinetons, hippo hobblies, street fleets, torn in taxes, metafogs, circuses and wards motes and basilikirks and aeropagods. While Joyce was discovering how to make a Heraclitean circle of the modern and the archaic, joining the end to the beginning, Velimir Khlebnikov in Russia was making a similar fusion of old and new, opening words etymologically, reviving old Russian, and treating themes from folklore, all in the name of the most revolutionary modernity. His friend, Vladimir Tatlin, who liked to call himself the Khlebnikov of constructivist art, spent 30 years trying to build and fly Leonardo's ornithopter. And what is the only surviving of Russian futurism, Lenin's tomb, but the tumulus of a Scythian king combined with an Egyptian mastaba, complete with mummy? Beyond all this passion for the archaic, which is far more pervasive in the arts of our time than can be suggested here, is a longing for something lost, for energies, values, and certainties unwisely abandoned by an industrial age. Things, Proust says, are gods, and one way our arts seem to regard our world is to question what gods have come to dwell among us in the internal combustion engine, the cash register, and the computer. One answer to this question lies in a single, rich symbol, which is of such ambiguity that we can read only part of its meaning. It is an elusive symbol, to be traced on the wing. We can begin with the mysterious painting, Hide and Seek, by the Russian painter Pavel Chelichev. This enormous painting, now in the Museum of Modern Art, is a pictorial equivalent of the method of Finnegan's Wake. All of its images are puns, which resolve into yet other punning images. First of all, it is a great oak tree against which a girl presses herself. She is the it in a game of hide and seek. The hiders are concealed in the tree itself. So many children, who are arranged like the cycle of the seasons, winter children, summer children. These children, seen a few paces back, become landscapes, and eventually two folded arms, as the tree itself resolves into a foot and hand. And further back, the face of a Russian demon, mustached and squint-eyed. Further back, the whole picture resolves into a drop of water. Leeuwenhoek's drop of water under the microscope, in which he discovered a new world of little animals. The drop of crystal dew on a leaf at morning, which acts like Borges's olive, or Blake's grain of sand, or any Leibnizian monad mirroring the whole world around it. Niels Bohr's drop of water, the surface tension of which led him to explain the structure of the atom. This is a very modern picture, then, a kind of metaphysical poem about our non-Euclidean, indeterminate world. But at its center there is the one opaque detail in the painting, the girl in a pinafore hiding her face against the tree. She is, let us say, the same girl who, as Alice, went into the Freudian dark called Wonderland and through the looking glass into the reflected, dimensionless realm of word and picture. She is Undine, Cicely Alexander, Rima, Clara Delibes, Grigia, Ada. She is Anna Livia Plurabel, the Persephone of Pound's Cantos, Brancusi's Maestra Birds, the women in Antonioni's films. She is a symbolic figure who serves in the imagery of modern art as the figure of Kore in the rites of Demeter of the ancient world. A catalogue of her experiences will disclose that she emerges in romantic literature toward the beginning of the 19th century. If we say that she is a symbol of the soul, we do not mean that she is consciously so, except in the imagination of writers who, like Dino Campana, Proust, Joyce, and Pound, were aware of her persistence and pervasiveness. She appears as a half-acknowledged ghost in Poe, who knew that she came from the ancient world and named her Lygia and Helen. She is all but wholly disguised in Ruskin, where her name is Rose, and where her new Hades, the industrial world, is accurately identified. Picasso depicts her with proper iconography, a girl carrying a dove, the Sicilian Persephone, and places her near a minotaur, his symbol for a world half brutal. She is a constant figure in the fiction of Eudora Welty, who is aware of her transformation into Eurydice, Helen, Pandora, Aphrodite, Danae, Psyche. She is the magic female phantom in Jules Lafogue and Gérard de Nerval, in Rilke and Leopardi. An ambiguous symbol of life and death, she is Odette de Crécy, as Swann imagines her in love, a girl from Botticelli, a lyrical phrase in Vinteuil's sonata, a flower. But she is also the depraved Odette, whose music is not Vinteuil, but Offenbach's Orphée aux Enfers, a witch of sensuality and deception, a fleur du mal. In an age when the human spirit is depressed and constrained, this symbol of the soul is a depiction of Persephone or Eurydice in Hades. In a euphoric or confident time, she is above ground, a Beatrice, an Aphrodite. Knowing this, We can read Rossetti's paintings and Swinburne's poems as hymns to the soul underground, the soul sunk in ungrowing matter, allied with sterile gold and crystal, but itself, like Persephone, a seed with the power to reach upward to the light. This light is the principal counter to dark, the sun, Demeter's torch, Orpheus's lyre, man's regard for the earth's resources, and the Themis of heaven. Where the soul is depressed beyond hope, we have a Poe writing a black parody of the myth of Orpheus and Eurydice. Roderick Usher, with his hypersensitive lute and his schizophrenic, Hamlet-like indecision, whose will is rotten and perverse, who is terrified by existence itself, and diabolically puts his Eurydice in Hades, and spinelessly leaves her there. In Roderick Usher, we see the emergence of the symbolic gear of the complementary myth, which runs alongside that of Persephone Eurydice in modern art. That lute will turn up on the cubist tabletop, in the iconography of Cocteau and Apollinaire, in Rilke and de Nerval. It will, with idiotic faithfulness, turn up on the study table of Sherlock Holmes, along with Usher's opium and erudite books about subterranean journeys. But then we remember that Holmes is Roderick Usher all over again, with Auguste Dupin thrown in. Dupin, who could not find a Persephone named Marie Roget, but could identify the dark power which raped the ladies on the Rue Morgue, and that Holmes is also derived from the man who drew the gaudiest picture of subterranean Persephone in the 19th century, saying that she is older than the rocks among which she sits, that like the vampire she has been dead many times and learned the secrets of the grave, the man who retold the myth of Cupid and Psyche for the 19th century, Walter Pater. Orpheus, then, is one archaic ghost we have revived and put to work, bringing us out of the sterile dark. And Persephone, in many disguises, is our way of seeing the soul lost and in trouble. Persephone's most powerful evocations are in Joyce and Pound, as Molly Bloom and Anna Livia, and as Pound's Homeric array of women, pre-Raphaelite of beauty and pre-Raphaelite of distress. For Pound, these women are symbols of the power of regeneration. Lucrezia Borgia is among them, a literal queen of death who had her springtime at the end of her life, the reformed Este Borgia. Madame Heil, Pound calls her, Lady Nature, who takes the shape of tree or animal only through a cooperation with light. For Joyce, the regeneration of the spirit is a cyclic female process, like the self-purifying motion of a river. One of Joyce's strong themes is the human paralysis of will that stubbornly resists regeneration. And Anna Livia, at the end of Finnegan's Wake, is resisting her plunge into the sea, much as Eveline in Dubliners balks at changing her life. Though the triumphant Molly Bloom, Demeter and Persephone together, cries out at one point to her creator, "Oh, Jamesy, let me up out of this." Once this theory is sorted out and anatomized, we shall see that the artists for whom the soul in plight can be symbolized as Persephone surround her with an imagery of green nature, especially the flowering tree, which was one of her forms in the ancient Mediterranean world. Joyce, Chelitchev, and Pound are clear examples of this correspondence of tree and maiden. So are Ruskin and Lewis Carroll, Francis Jammes and Proust, Yeats and Jules Supervielle. The poets who replace Persephone with Eurydice work under the sign of the lute of Orpheus. La Fogue, Rilke, Poe, and we should not hesitate to add Braque, Orff, and Picasso. And if we ask why our artists have reached back to such archaic symbols to interpret the distress of mind and soul in our time, There are partial but not comprehensive answers. One reason, I suggest, is the radical change in our sense of what is alive and what isn't. We have recovered in anthropology and archaeology the truth that primitive man lives in a world totally alive, a world in which one talks to bears and reindeer, like the Laplanders, or to coyote, the sun and moon, like the Plains Indians. In the 17th century, we discovered that a drop of water is alive. In the 18th century, that all of nature is alive in its discrete particles. In the 19th century, that these particles are all dancing a constant dance, the Brownian movement. And the 20th century discovered that nothing at all is dead, that the material of existence is so many little solar systems of light mush, or as Einstein said, every clod of earth, every feather, every speck of dust is a prodigious reservoir of entrapped energy. We had a new vision that death and life are a complementary pattern. Darwin and Wallace demonstrated this, but in ways that were more disturbing than enlightening, and Darwin's vision seemed destitute of a moral life. The nearest model for a world totally alive was the archaic era of our own culture, pre-Aristotelian Greece and Rome. From that world, we began to feel terribly alienated, as the railroad tracks went down and the factories up, as our sciences began to explain the mechanics of everything and the nature of nothing. The first voices of protest, which cried that man is primarily a spirit, the voices of Blake, Shelley, and Leopardi, sounded sufficiently deranged, and we had to hear the equally dubious voices of Nietzsche, Freud, and Jung before we could begin seriously to listen. It was, however, the artists who were performing the great feat of awakening an archaic sense of the world. The first effort was a clear outgrowth of Renaissance neoclassicism and led to a revolution in which the themes were subversively rejuvenated. Shelley's Platonism, for instance, and Blake's kitchen-forged mythology, the metacultural visions of a Novalis or Baudelaire. The second effort can be called the Renaissance of 1910, which recognized the archaic. Hilda Doolittle, Pound, and Williams could catalyze poetry by returning to the Greek fragment, to archaic simplicity, to a sense of reality that was fresh because it had been so long neglected. Brancusi, Gautier-Bjeska, Modigliani, Picasso turned to the energy and liveliness of primitive art. The piano, Stravinsky announced, was a percussion instrument, like a drum from the jungle. The artist Wyndham Lewis said, looking at prehistoric paintings that seemed to be excused from the ravages of time, "The artist goes back to the fish." Whether indeed the century's sense of the archaic served to alleviate our alienation from what was once most familiar, or whether it put our alienation into even starker contrast to ages in which we romantically suppose man to have lived more harmoniously and congenially with his gods and with nature, it is too early to say. Certainly it has deepened our tragic sense of the world and set us on a search to know what the beginnings of our culture were. Only our age has prepared itself to feel the significance of an engraved ox rib 230,000 years old, or to create and respond to a painting like Picasso's Guernica, executed in allusion to the style of Aurignacian reindeer hunters of 50,000 years ago. On the other hand, our search for the archaic may have contributed to our being even more lost. For the search is, for the moment, now over in the arts, and our poets are gypsies camping in ruins once again. Persephone and Orpheus have reverted to footnotes in anthologies. The classic sense of the city perished rather than revived in the Renaissance of 1910, which had spent its initial energies by 1914 and was exhausted by 1939, the year of the publication of Finnegan's Wake, and of the beginning of the second destruction of the world in 25 years. Some of the masters lived on. Pound wrote two more masterpieces. Picasso continued, filling 80 years of his life with work, completing a painting every 72 hours of that time. Men have walked on the moon, stirring dust that had not moved since millennia before the archaic hand carved the images on the Sarla bone, which mean nothing to our eyes. The world that drove Ruskin and Pound mad has worsened in precisely the ways they said it would. Eliot's wasteland has extended its borders. Rilke's freak show, outside which the barker invites us to come in and see the genitals of money, is a feature of every street. Never has an age had more accurate prophets in its writers and painters. The donation remains to be assessed and understood, and the discovery or invention of the archaic is as splendid a donation as that of Hellenism to the Renaissance. We are just now seeing, amidst the fads and distractions, the strange fact that what has been most modern in our time was what was most archaic, and that the impulse to recover beginnings and primal energies grew out of a feeling that man, in his alienation, was drifting tragically away from what he had first made as poetry and design, and as an understanding of the world. Here are Ezra Pound's last lines. Poetry speaks phallic direction. Song keeps the word forever. Sound is molded to mean this, and the measure molds sound. This is a translation from an archaic Chinese text, explaining that poetry is a voice out of nature which must be rendered humanly intelligible, so that people can know how to live. Another Odyssey. Wie alles Metaphysische ist die Harmonie zwischen Gedanken und Wirklichkeit in der Grammatik der Sprache aufzufinden. Like everything metaphysical, the harmony between thought and reality is to be found in the grammar of the language. Wittgenstein, Zettel 55. Salvatore Quasimodo translates the three lines that begin the third book of the Odyssey. Il sole, lasciata la serena distesa dell'acqua, si levò verso il cielo di rame a illuminare gli dèi e gli uomini destinati alla morte sulla terra feconda. What Aelius departs from here is not thalassa or pontos, but limne, an inlet of the sea. The word later comes to mean a marsh or pooled tide water, and is also used to mean a lake. Telemachus and Athena are sailing into the Bay of Navarino, where they see the sacrifices at Pylos of the Sands. The poet calls the bay a limne, and adds that it is very beautiful, perikalea. Signor Quasimodo folds these two images together as la serena distesa dell'acqua, as smoothly as he takes polycalcon as a color adjective describing the glaring dawn sky. Richmond Lattimore gives limne the first meaning offered by the Reverends Little and Scott, standing water. Helios, leaving behind the lovely standing waters, rose up. As for the sky, Professor Lattimore calls it brazen, as do Samuel Henry Butcher and Andrew Lang, Robert Fitzgerald, William Cullen Bryant, and William Morris. Chapman understands the adjective to include both the hardness and gleam of bronze. The sun now left the great and goodly lake, and to the firm heaven bright ascent did make. English words, Joseph Conrad complained, say more than you want them to say. Oaken, for instance, has overtones which force one to say in remarking that a table is de chêne, that it is also solid and British. Brazen and standing waters are not phrases that a stylist, poet, or prose writer would consider without making certain that he wanted the overtones as well. Except, of course, when he is asking the reader to agree that he is writing in a high style, the dignity of which prevents one from imagining anything but the purest lexicographic content of every word. Such a request might be backed up by asking the reader to keep well in mind at all times that the text before him translates a great poem, said by people who know to be magnificent. With such an understanding between translator and reader, the translator can then write Immortals, where Homer has Athanati, and Mortals, where Homer has Thniti, and forget that the two words were worn out years ago. A translator who dares not ask such an agreement feels compelled to convey the sharpness of the Greek. Signor Quasimodo has seen the interplay in the homily, has thought about it, and puts it into seamless contemporary words. The sun shines on the gods, and on men who must someday die, and on the fecund earth. Chapman manages to keep the two possible meanings of Zidoros, giver of life, or giver of Zia, one of the most primitive of grains. To shine as well upon the mortal birth, inhabiting the ploughed life-giving earth, as on the ever-treaders upon death. Lattimore's Mortal Men, Quasimodo's Gli uomini destinati alla morte, Chapman's ever-treaders upon death? Which replaces a Greek word with a dictionary equivalent, and which tries to unfold the Greek sense? Show me, Wittgenstein liked to say, how a man uses a word, and I'll tell you what he really thinks about it. No word in a context can have more meaning than the writer thinks into it. When a writer does not care about the meaning of a word, we know it. We also know how a man cares about words. We know from his words what he honors, what he is unaware of, and how he modifies, with his individual use of it, the culture in which he exists. When, for instance, William Cullen Bryant translates the passage we are analyzing, "Now from the fair broad bosom of the sea, into the brazen vault of heaven the sun, rose shining for the immortals and for men, upon the foodful earth," we notice the translator shying away from particular description. He has a bay and a ploughed field that he is content to render invisible. He introduces a bosom and a vault, and he is not afraid that in recitation the audience will hear foodful as a tongue-twisted fruitful. There is a kind of Thanksgiving piety in Bryant. The sea is a bosom. Homer elsewhere calls it unharvestable. The firmament is a bit of decorative architecture, which we should no doubt stand in awe of. And the sun shines for gods and men. Homer merely says that it shines on them. Professor Lattimore has the sun shining on gods and men, but across the grain field. A gratuitous angle that shows us that a grain field for Professor Lattimore is a pretty landscape primarily, and the source of life secondarily. Robert Fitzgerald sees the generosity of the sun. "All one brightenin' for gods immortal and for mortal men, on ploughlands kind with grain," and hides altogether the idea of death and fecundity occurring together under the eyes of the gods and the indifferent sun. Mr. Fitzgerald likes to freeze time when he comes to the lovely passages, savoring a still beauty. Homer's very beautiful bay is the flawless brimming sea. He removes Homer's shadows and makes the scene golden, kind with grain. If you don't care about words at all, it can be translated thus. As the sun rose from the beautiful mirror of the sea to climb to the brazen heaven and shine with his light on gods and on men that inhabit the grain-giving earth. This is simply a rewording, executed in 1948 by S.O. Andrew, of William Morris's "Now uprose the sun, and leaving the exceeding lovely mirror, fared up to the brazen heaven, to the deathless shining clear, and unto deathful men on the corn-kind earth that dwell." Morris was at least trying to keep the reader aware that the poem is of an age. Mr. Andrew has sealed himself up in himself and is having a wonderful time. But back to Professor Lattimore. Here is the beginning of the account of the hunt on Parnassus, where Odysseus was scarred by the boar. "But when the young dawn showed again with her rosy fingers, they went out on their way to the hunt, the dogs and the people, these sons of Autolycus, and with them noble Odysseus went." Is it not a bit chewing gummy to say that dawn showed? Johnson gives 10 definitions of show, none of which sanctions this suppressed reflexive, and Fowler clucks his tongue if consulted on the matter. Webster's Third International describes the intransitive show and takes its example of usage from H.A. Sinclair. "I'm glad you showed, kid." And out on their way? As for the went, that's where Homer put it. And dear rosy-fingered Dawn, she turns up in the Fairy Queen about the time Chapman was putting her into his Iliads. It's a toss-up as to who stole her from whom. She is the Kilroy of Homeric translation. Professor Lattimore continues. "They came to the steep mountain, mantled in forest, Parnassus, and soon they were up in the windy folds." Colonel Lawrence has wind-swept upper folds. Morris, windy gills. At this time, the sun had just begun to strike on the ploughlands, rising out of the quiet water and the deep stream of the ocean. The hunters came to the wooded valley, and on ahead of them ran the dogs, casting about for the tracks, and behind them the sons of Autolycus, and with them noble Odysseus went close behind the hounds, shaking his spear, far shadowing. Now there, inside that thick of the bush, was the lair of a great boar. Neither could the force of wet-blown winds penetrate here, nor could the shining sun ever strike through with his rays, nor yet could the rain pass all the way through it, so close together it grew, with a fall of leaves drifted in dense profusion. The thudding made by the feet of men and dogs came to him as they closed on him in the hunt, and against them he from his wood lair bristled strongly his nape, and with fire from his eyes glaring, stood up to face them close. Ploughlands is an archaic word, once an exact measure. The quiet water of the ocean avoids the traditional soft blowing, but what does it mean? Surely Homer meant to describe a calm sea, not to calculate the amount of noise it was making. Casting about for the tracks? Here Professor Lattimore should have kept to Little and Scott, who say casting about for the scent. Dogs do not follow tracks, a visual skill, but the smell of their prey. Why noble Odysseus? He is no nobler than his uncles, and to single him out with such a word seems to put him in contrast to his very family. He's a stripling here. Surely Homer means charming or handsome. Professor Lattimore, in his faithfulness, places himself at the mercy of the merciless Greek language. His boar bristled strongly his nape, and with fire from his eyes glaring, stood up to face them close. The verb is most certainly bristled, and the noun nape, but a boar is a very special kind of animal, whose bristling is a thing unto itself, and his nape, like a snake's neck, is more a word than a reality. The very same words might be used of a cat, and we would have to translate camelled his back and bushed. A boar hunches his shoulders. He hackles. He burrs up. Mr. Fitzgerald has, with razor back bristling and raging eyes, he trotted and stood at bay. Splendid, that trotted and stood. Professor Lattimore has the boar lying down until the dogs are at his door, which is a bit cool, even for such an insolent beast as this one. Here is how Mr. Fitzgerald begins the boar hunt. When the young dawn spread in the eastern sky, her fingertips of rose. Both Chapman and Pope ducked, having to do something with a rhododactylos eos here, Chapman looking to the sun's heat and Pope to its color for a paraphrase. Chapman knows his out of doors and has not forgotten that the hunters have just spent the night on the ground. Pope saw the dawn through windows. Fitzgerald, writing in a century whose every gesture is timed, adds motion to the venerable epithet. The men and dogs went hunting, taking Odysseus. Odysseus loses his Dios, and the sons of Autolycus their patronymic. No matter, that information is well established, and Mr. Fitzgerald doesn't need formulae. They climbed Parnassus' rugged flank mantled in forest. Pope's Parnassus, thick perplexed with horrid shades, has alternately an English and a Latin word. What we are discussing is a line of Virgil, every other word of which has been glossed into English. Homer, we might note, is at some distance, and his more cultivated imitator has the stage. Entering amid high windy folds at noon, when Helios beat upon the valley floor, and on the winding ocean whence he came. The amid is not current English. Fold is not good American, but British. Lawrence, wind-swept upper folds. And is it at noon or just after sunrise that they reach the high gorges? The winding is taken from Homeric cosmography rather than from the text, which says deep. But what a clear, solidly paced three lines. Bryant's airy heights, the sun new risen from the deep ocean's gently flowing stream, now smote the fields, misses the look of a great mountain, tries, like Fitzgerald, to tuck in Homer's earth-encircling ocean, and makes a mess of it. The kind of paralytic total miss with an image that drives clever children and the literal-minded away from poetry altogether. Yet genteel readers, in Bryant's day, took that stream as a refinement. And the gently, their experience of the sea to the contrary, as evidence of Bryant's higher soul. The version reaches solid ground with the biblical smote. But Bryant is simply Wordsworthing around here. Four words on, he's talking about a dell. Fitzgerald continues. With hounds questing ahead, in open order, the sons of Autolycus went down a glen, Odysseus in the lead, behind the dogs, pointing his long shadowing spear. Fitzgerald deploys dogs and hunters in a forward motion. Questing ahead. In the lead, pointing. Professor Lattimore scatters the motion, casting about, behind them, close behind, shaking. There is an outwardness to Fitzgerald's rhythms that makes Lattimore sound distinctly bumpy. Translation involves two languages. The translator is in constant danger of inventing a third that lies between, a treacherous, non-existent language, suggested by the original and not recognized by the language into which the original is being transposed. The Greek says, of Odysseus the loved son, and Professor Lattimore translates, the dear son of Odysseus. Who uses such language in English? Chapman's Ulysses' Loved Son seems more contemporary. Bryant says, Dear Son, perhaps with an impunity that we feel we ought to withhold from Professor Lattimore. I once dined with Professor Lattimore, and he did not speak like William Cullen Bryant. He spoke a charming and fluent, and even racy colloquial English.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.